So it's January 1942, and the Second World War is entering its third full year, and young Philip Gray is at an aircrew selection board at Edinburgh, Scotland. Can you tell me what the war meant to you at the time and why you wanted to be a pilot in the Royal Air Force?
Well, as far as the war is concerned, we were facing a country that wanted to rule the world. So we were little Roman youths at the time. We wanted to do our bit to make sure that didn't happen.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and what was your first operational experience like?
Yeah, the first stop was, you're going up to, you can practice everything, but you can't practice going to war. The only way you can go to practice that is go to war. And the first attack we were on, operation, everything happened so fast that all the dangers even that were passed before we realised what happened. So it wasn't until about the third or fourth operation that the mayhem, the noise and smells began to come at us in a form we recognised. And you probably become more fearful then.
Right. Okay, so Sir Arthur Harris believed that bombing could win the war, and if Bomber Command was to defeat Germany, the goal was to reduce her war industry to rubble. Mm-hmm. So did you enter service knowing exactly what strategic or precision bombing meant?
Yes, I believe Arthur Harris that he could finish the war with area, contrary to what they say, because they wouldn't let him allow him to do what he wanted to do. You see, we'd watched the Luftwaffe set the ground rules. There was, Manchester, Liverpool, Coventry, London,
right.
Plymouth.
Right.
We saw that they were bombing indiscriminately. You see, we'd been allowed to bomb the same way. Because it started off with those three firestorms. You see, if you think of the end of the war, you're the Pacific War. They dropped two atomic bombs. Oh, I finished. I thought, Harris thought, how many firestorms are you going to put up with?
Right.
They brought the war to a stop. Mm-hmm. They just couldn't keep it up. But you see, Churchill put his foot down and they wouldn't, in humanity, they wouldn't allow it. You see, Arthur Harris had no compunctions about it. When you go to war, you don't do what George Bush did in 1992. You don't half fight a war.
Right.
If you're going to fight a war, you've got to go all the way.
Right.
And you see, they wouldn't allow Arthur. Arthur Harris could have won the war if they'd given him his head.
You're in it to see it through to the end.
Yeah, well, you could have stopped it.
Mm-hmm. So, before the advancement of technology to better the accuracy of bombing and navigation to the target area, strategic bombing had its problems. Approximately 3 bombs for every 100 fell within 5 miles of the target, and visual recognition of the target allowed for no better than about 5 to 7 mile proximity. And by 1941, Bomber Command losses totaled about 700 aircraft. While there was a measure of success, the picture wasn't all rosy, and all this was before inventions of GH radar and H2S in early 1943, eventually leading to much better navigation prior to your time entering operational flight. What are your thoughts on bombing effectiveness while the task was still in its infancy?
Yes, well, you see, the Germans were the same. It was an aerial war. When you're bombing from 20,000 feet, your chances of hitting the target. But I think after our boss's idea was, as long as they're hitting Germany, he didn't care.
So there was an element of indiscriminate bombing in there?
Oh, yeah.
Right.
They were given a target to hit. And the other days, it was probably, I think the radar came in quicker, it was 1942. They started to precision bombing. We could bomb as precise as anybody. But as far as bombing with a bomb sight is concerned.
Mm-hmm, right.
No matter if it's an ordinary bomb sight, everybody else's bomb sight.
Yeah.
At 20,000 feet, you can't guarantee anything.
Right.
Pickle battle or anything else.
At 20,000 feet, and see, how many days throughout the week could you actually have a clear visual on the target at that height?
You see, when the Pathfinders came in, and the Master Bomber, they started to bring the bombing more precise. But there were 7 bomber groups, and there were 3 groups. There's only one that every bomber, every, no matter what, it didn't have to be a Lancaster. Anyway, every bomber navigated by radar, whether it was Australia, New Zealand, Canada, or anybody else's.
Right.
We all navigated by radar. Our free group was the only one that bombed by radar as well. We had two sets. We bombed by radar. It was pretty accurate.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty accurate. Exactly as we wanted it to be.
So you flew many missions to industrial targets throughout the war. Now, one target, Gelsenkirchen, the objective was the Nordstrom oil refinery and benzene plant. And in the mission itself, you could see anti-aircraft shells exploding about 2 miles out. You witness kite on your port side eventually spiral after losing its tail section in the quick end to someone you know, Ian Cameron, or know of, who's Ian Cameron. Now, with competent navigation, you make it to the target. Blondie, one of your crew members, is injured after flak hits your aircraft, and luckily, after leaving the target, you don't intercept any fighters.
Yeah.
Could you talk a little bit more about that experience with Squadron 186?
Yeah, you see, the movies have made fighters, given them more importance. And fighters are just nuisance value. You could cope with fighters. What you couldn't cope with was the anti-aircraft fire. That brought down more bombers. And the fighters were just, I know you've seen the films Memphis Belle and Trouble
Right
High,
yeah.
But fighters were great cinema. Fighters were just really, on the whole, nuisance value. The only one we really feared was the Messerschmitt 262.
The jet fighter.
Because we had no answer to that.
Right.
We were flying at 20,000 feet by day. Our fighter cover was at 30,000 feet. But any height we could reach, the anti-aircraft fire could reach. And did. And brought down many of our planes, and certainly many more B-17s.
The Americans, right.
They flew in a different...
In their formation flying, they right.
36 ship formation, and... all at the same height, covering a huge bit of the sky. The ground gunners couldn't miss, and didn't. And the B-17, not to harp on about it, but the Mosquito could carry as many bombs as the B-17.
So the effectiveness of both of them was?
Well, obviously, a bomber command was effective, yeah.
Right.
We had a 33-foot bomb bay. We carried a bomb load that you would go up to 22,000 pounds. You need four B-17s to carry that.
The Americans are more in line with the medium rate, with the medium effectiveness of the medium bomber versus a heavy bomber, the RAF.
Yes, and the method of bombing was, as you could say, was antique.
Uh-huh.
I mean, you don't cover a huge bit of the sky all at the same height. That's asking for something, and they got it. And there were 10 young men who lost their lives, every B-17 that went down.
A 10-man
And they'd
crew.
Use the Mosquito, which could fly higher and faster, with a crew of two, the same bomb load, but they wouldn't do it. The Mosquito's built in Canada. No, they wouldn't use anything that's made in Canada.
Some political decisions involved in there, I'm sure, too, right?
So they'd used the Mosquito, they could have saved. And our radar, they could have saved tens of thousands of lives. They wouldn't do it.
So fighter attack over Germany was a constant threat. Unlike when you're going to a known location, you can expect or anticipate using your knowledge of enemy flak locations. So we just spoke a little bit about fighters being nothing more than a nuisance. But as a pilot yourself, what are some of your preoccupations given your job while in flight under fighter attack?
And the pilot was always the captain of the aircraft. And he got that title not for grandiose purposes, because if any lightning decisions had to be made, and there had to be lightning decisions, on the spot to say, and he hoped like Hades that they were the right ones, that you had to say, you come near attack, things could happen at any time, and you have to make a quick decision.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't have everybody, you can't have no time to have a consensus or a...
Right, a not a committee meeting on... Right.
You just, the captain makes a decision and that's it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so... Was it there were industrial targets with the greatest concentration of guns per square mile and opposition from anti-aircraft units, flak, fighter attack, which presented the greatest threat to completing your objectives?
Yes, anti-aircraft fire.
Mm-hmm.
They were the biggest menace. See, sitting in the middle of Europe, Germany has been making war one way or another on that people for 1,000 years. They're very good at it. Never, ever underestimate the Germans. Because they're very good.
A formidable opponent.
Yes, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so, in a situation like that, what effect did the morale have when your next operation was a target over the war? What did that mean to your crew after you go through your mission briefing and you know that your target is going to be a heavily defended target like the war?
Actually, the bulk of our targets were the war. So we got as about the third or fourth or fifth operation, you get accustomed to the carnage coming at you, and noises and things. So you got the funny thing to say, but you got accustomed to the carnage, to the noises, and you actually got accustomed to it. Not that the fear went away.
I see.
Each one of us has a thing called adrenaline. Adrenaline is what stirs you up when you come back. Yes, you're scared stiff when you're going at the target, but then you come back.
There's no more adrenaline.
You're feeling great.
Yeah. So unlike the majority of Bomber Command flying at night, your squadron, number 186, was an ops squadron flying mainly daytime raids, not unlike the Americans were. What did the challenges unique to daytime flight present to you as pilot?
Well, first of all, you flew in a bomber stream, each squadron 500 differential between each squadron,
okay.
And you had fighter cover above, so it was more organized. And I like night flying, but day flying was became the harder of the day. More war control.
Okay, so did formation flying provide you with a sense that you stood a good chance to make it back home?
Yeah, when you say formation flying, we really didn't fly in formation. We flew in loose formation.
Mm-hmm.
But
a little different than the American method.
Yeah, oh yeah.
They
flew in 36 ship formations, which is the, so they say they had no consistency in their navigation, so they had to.
I see. One thing I know you did near the end of the war, during the late stages of the war, you were part of the effort repatriating Allied POWs back to England. So, can you tell me what that experience meant to you and perhaps your crew, where you were afforded with a type of opportunity to do something as important as that?
Yeah, it was first one we did, all these men had been prisoners of war for 4 and 5 years. And the flight across the channel to a fighter airfield. Just as far as we were concerned, it was just another flight.
Right.
It wasn't to them. When they landed, you see these men, usually Ford Airfield was beautiful grass string airfield, which was beautiful to see. And they had come from a prison of war, and suddenly they were in this beautiful. A lot of them were dumbstruck, kissing the ground. And others were crying.
Right.
So after the first operation, we realized that all we were was the the taxi drivers. And on the next lot we brought, we just dropped them, said cheerio, and walked away. And we left them to their own devices because we hadn't earned the right to be back there. We had to earn the right to be back there, and we hadn't done that. Mm. So I told the boys to walk away.
Yeah.
Leave them to, they wanted to cry or kiss the ground or do what they like.
Right.
Just dumbstruck. That was their affair, nothing to do with us. So, you know.
Once returning from a mission, one had to count the cost. And that meant waiting to see what crew returned and which crew would not. The war brought the difficult and hard reality that this was serious business. How did coping with the loss of fellow aircrew during the war differ once the war ended? So how, once the war was over, did that provide for a lot of time to reflect on people you knew?
Even during training, you could lose. Lots of crews were lost in training.
Well, an operational training unit, right?
No, even in training to become pilots. We lost 3 of our British flying training school, course 16. Out of 100 that went, only 50 came out as pilots. Off of his 50, three were killed in one night of night flying.
Mm-hmm.
So these were great guys. They were people we knew well.
Mm-hmm.
And they were gone.
Yeah.
Just they hadn't even got their wings.
So you knew even in training just how serious the business was.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so then in closing, when reflecting on the recognition of the contribution of Bomber Command to winning the war, what are your thoughts of the legacy and contribution of the air effort in winning World War II?
The air war.
The air war.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, I like to think that the Army and the Navy fought battles. The Bomber Command, at least the Army, and the same with the Fighter Command, they fought a war. In other words, they were going out night and day.
Mm-hmm.
For the D-Day, for instance, the Americans, the Canadians, and the British were training the armies. It was a tricky operation for about a year before the D-Day came along.
Right.
You see, all during that year, they weren't in any danger. We were going out night and day bombing.
Right.
Germany.
Right. There was all the way up until, I think it was March 1944, until Schaeff took control of Bomber Command for the preparation for D-Day, you guys were still flying missions.
We fought a war. The Army and the Navy fought battles.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you, Philip Ray.
Thank you.